Okay, let me introduce to you the talk that I am going to show you. It's about the global abbreviation. It's a joint work that I was developing with Albert Corral and Christian Benz and Ramon Ferret. My role in this team is to analyze the statistical properties because the language, the properties that exhibit the laws in a statistical language several times are around some topics of entropy or something like this. But from a statistical point of view, you can see a more mathematical approach. Okay, the outline of the talk is to remark the two points, statistical modeling and the fifth law of abbreviation. Let me to start with the fifth one, and okay, I have to say that it's a bit theoretical approach, but I think it's a good way to introduce the main ideas around the collaboration of the statistical modeling in statistical analysis. Okay, the first one I want to remark that from a statistical point of view is the most important is data. Model it's so far the idea of language and to try to understand types and tokens and some concepts are related to that. The main idea is you have some data, you have a model, and you have a way to link both data and model. Three components that are very that is a very theoretical approach in the sense of each relation is based on mathematical properties in probability theory, and remark that, for instance, the link between data and model from a statistical modeling point of view is always considered using the likelihood theory. This is the point that is so close to the theoretical methods in language statistics and statistical analysis. This is the idea, as you know, around the entropy or some topics around that. Okay, likelihood theory remark that is in some way to try to search when you have a model given by some probability distribution with some parameters, you try to get a way to describe when you know the data, who is the parameters. And this has to be, this equal, it has to be approximation of the probability of when you have some data, but given the parameters. It's a changing the conditional distribution. In this approach, that is our main approach in statistical modeling, the part is when you have data, this value, and model, you need to know who is the parameter. With this idea, the parameter is the value here that maximizes the likelihood. It's the idea of maximizing the entropy. Then it's a base of a statistical model. However, many times it's not possible to use this approach, and then there are several techniques, and there are a lot of different methodologies around to try to get different parameters here. But I am going to take this point for your interest in order to connect the statistical modeling and this idea of to search properties in languages or some complex systems. Okay, in the statistical model, there are a part, the important part is extreme value theory. Extended theory is based, it is a probability theory, it's a part of probability theory, and it's based on to analyze only the extreme of the distribution. It's not important the distribution, it's not important the model for all data, only it's important the model for high value of the data, for the extremes of the data. Extreme value theory is start with the first theorem who characterizes the maximum for a distribution. If you have, you can suppose that you have a data, you can show the histogram or something like this, and you have some distribution, you don't know, but the extent value theory is interested in to know what is happening here. For higher values of the variable, the random variable, to know which is this distribution. Or you know some properties here. Then the first point was the first fundamental theorem was characterizing that given a distribution, given a random variable, to know who is the maximum of x. You can see some similarities with the classical statistical modeling that is worried for given a random variable to model expectation of random variable. It's a classical statistical modeling. This is a extent value theory, basically in that. Okay, this one, this is a point that the same way that expectation or the expected value of a random variable is like a normal distribution, the first theorem attempts to say that the maximum of a distribution is generalized extent value distribution. It's other family, also a parametric family, who can characterize from a asymptotic point of view which is the maximum for a given variable, for a given random variable. Other concept was to understand which is exactly the meaning of the tail. You see, for instance, this example, this is a data, it's a histogram, and you want to know what is happening here. The main idea for index value theory is to consider, put the sample, rescale in order to get a probability measure, and translate to zero. This is the main approach in extent value theory. I want to remark that it's going to translate to zero. This will be so different than the typical approach in complex systems around the power law. Based on that, you can get a way to characterize for a given threshold, which is happened here. And the second fundamental theorem in EBT is just to say which is exactly this distribution from a asymptotical point of view. And say that if the threshold is large, it's enough, then the distribution in the tail is exactly GPD, the GPD distribution. Then in here, we are going to put a GPD distribution. This is very close to power law, and then I'm going to show. But I want to remark that the main point of view, from a theoretical point of view, is the existence of a family who characterizes the tails, and this family has two parameters, G and C. The first one is a tail index from theoretical approach, but you can know as the slope when you see a power law, this index characterizes a power law, the shape. And the other one is the scale. Okay, you can see that from a statistical point of view, you have two problems. The first one, you have to get a way to fit this model, and it's not easy. There are several research around that. And another problem is to search what is the optimal threshold from a statistical point of view. This is like a problem that you have if you are, I suppose, everybody knows power law, and the problem is where I have to put and when, then how I can compute the tail index. Okay, let me to show who is GPD. The algebraic distribution, the smallest distribution function is given by this expression. This one is for G positive, is the case who is close to power law. But you can see the parameterization is so different. The first difference is because the support of x is between 0 and infinity. 0 is included because this part in expression lets you do. And here you can see, and I don't want to show anything else about that, but remark that GPD includes all kinds of tails, not only tails with support 0 infinity. You can have a tail with a support, a compact support. Then GPD is going to consider all possibilities. The main property of GPD is that the coefficient of variation, remark that is the deviation divided, coefficient of variation is the standard deviation, mu1 divided by the mean, but from theoretical point of view is the root square of the variance divided by 4 respective values, have this form. This statistic, or this new random variable mu1, only depends for that for one parameter. The parameter is k is repeated. It's a main property of the, it's a very important property and characterizes GPD. Other property is when you have a GPD with two parameters, chip C and neutron K, you can imagine that you put and translate to zero, and then again put and translate to zero, then you are going to get again a GPD, because in any other case the theorem will be so strange to say for U tends to infinity. Then you can see the exact expression is that detailing that is the same, but the scale is going to change in order where you are putting and put and translating. Remark only so quick that GPD in depending on the chi parameter, let me to say chi parameter is tail index or extreme value index. It's a theoretical notation. When it's negative, you can think it's a light tail with compact support. When it's chi equal to zero, it's exponential tail. Want to say that in some place you can cut, and here you can see exponential distribution. And heavy tail is just the case that always know in complex systems or around complex systems analysis, and correspond to chi positive. Remark that chi, the parameterization, maybe it's more interesting to see here or beta dependent. This is exactly the slope in power law. Chi is the typical way to consider the tail index, and beta is this idea of the shape of power law. The idea that what is the degree of the polynomial from an analytic point of view who corresponds here. So my idea, when you do GPD, GPD is a general theoretical approach, but in general you try to put that a power law, and in each case you are going to put a polynomial decay in the table. Okay, to remark, power law, everybody knows, it's just this form with just one parameter. This parameter can be interpreted as the slope of PDF in log-log scale. And I think it's necessary to say anything else because everybody knows power law. But I'm going to show the relation because it's obvious the relation. GPD and power law are models with polynomial decay, but the theoretical point of view is GPD. Then, which is the connection? Okay, if you can see from theoretical point of view, always you are going to see, if you know that your distribution don't have a compact support, it's going to infinity, then only two possibilities, exponential decay or polynomial decay. Then it's not a surprise that you detect a power law in the tail. Always when you have data, you have to get or exponential in some cases, or polynomial decay. No more possibilities from theoretical point of view. But from theoretical point of view, then to put a scale parameter. And power law don't have scale parameter. Power law is don't need the scale parameter. This is the particular, this is the show that a power law just corresponds to a particular case of GPD. GPD, when you could and translate, where you could correspond to the scale parameter. In this case, is when you obtain the power law. Then the power law really is a particular case of general separator distribution, but it's really surprising from a theoretical point of view for me, is that when you have experimental data, with the units, from an experiment, but the scale parameters from theoretical point of view is not necessary because when you could, the point where you could have that scale information. Maybe for you it's so easy, it's so trivial But from the technical point of view, there aren't anything who justify that. Okay. Now let me to talk about RCV package. RCV package is a package we are developing with a team in Barcelona. It's allowed to analyze the empirical residual coefficient of variation. You can see that I say the coefficient of variation for GPD only depend of tail index. And I say when I cut a GPD and translate, always the G is the same. Then, if I take a data and cut, translate, compute coefficient of variation, again, cut, translate, compute the coefficient of variation in some moment, the result is constant because arrives to GPD, arrives to polynomial decay. This is an example of CV plot, this idea to represent for each point, you have to suppose that you have that data given by the order statistics. It's only to sort the data. Then you, this idea that you are going to put every time for a higher values, and each time I'm going to translate to zero, compute the residual coefficient of variation, and plot. For each point, for each order statistical, this blue line is the CV. Then it's a way to represent when it's going to be constant. You can see here, I consider a sample, different sample size for a tail, and here the tail is 256 higher values, then here in the end only 16 higher values. And for each one I can compute the coefficient of variation. I am going to compute and compute. You can see these values are going to be represented here. The idea.
What do you have on the x-axis? Hmm? What do you have on the x-axis in the plot?
Here you have the coefficient of variation, the coefficient, and in here, in this one, you have the index, the rank. For instance, when you put if your data has 2,000, in here there are the position of the in here there are the coefficient of the residual coefficient of variation for the 500 higher values.
And you
okay, you can change the scale.
And you choose a suitable order. You choose an order that you wish.
Yeah. No, the order is the sort.
Sorting.
For the random data, yeah.
By the okay, the simple run. Okay.
Yes, this is an annotation. When we put the string and we
Okay,
then there are several methods. Only remark where you are. In here it's a CV plot, it's other tool, but you know this typical tool that is computing the maximum likelihood estimation for the tail index, for the alpha, for a power law, under power law assumption. This is a maximum, this is only this four. This is a method. You can see the plot like before with this way. This is known, this feature is known as Hill plot. And for instance, closest classic, there are other way to get how to put and where is the tail. There are several ways. I only want to remind there are two more classical methods, and the other one is a new proposal. The advantage of this one is you can do inference about that. If you have, for instance, for the previous example, you have a coefficient of variation, but you can compute for each coefficient of variation that you observe, which is the p-value under the hypothesis of exponentiality, for example. You can test if the tail is exponential. You can test if the tail is exponential. For each residual coefficient that you obtain, you can compute a p-value. But in the end, for different input points, you have different p-values, and then it's so difficult to decide, because in here you have to combine to get a multiple test in order to combine and decide, and you have only one decision. Is really the tail or not tail? In this case, exponential. Okay. let me to show the example of coefficient variation of the residual the CV plot from theoretical for a parametric family, in this case a log normal. You can see this is a data, real data, typically modeled with log normal distribution, and the black line corresponds to the residual coefficient of variation. Remark with that residual coefficient of variation characterizes the probability density function, characterizes the distribution of the random variable. You say, if you give me the PDF, I know the measure. If you give me CDF, I know the measure. Again, if I give you zero coefficient of variation, you can know the measure. It's another way to describe the measure. Okay, so quick, because it's very theoretical approach and now it's so difficult to explain, but the idea is to consider a TM statistic and a statistic who combine each one of the residual coefficient of variation in order that the decision, the final decision, is not as you put here, and I want to see if this alpha is okay. You are going to put several times and then decide if the join that you see it's really a good fit. This is an example of application. Now I am going to introduce that the main text that I am going to use, the main data, was Clarissa. It's a very large novel in English. Then I am going to use this one to show some properties. In here, I consider the frequency, it's an example of how you can use the SV packet. But for instance, to show when you can try with the first part, try the first attention for first for selection, where I have to put. It's not necessarily exactly here, but more or less where I have to put. You have a function, and you can obtain from this case that the extreme. With the theorist function, detect that the energy difference that you have to consider is this one. And then with a function Tn, you can compute the p-value associated to these n extremes. In this case, consider the Ebi is this one. It's computed as 1.16, like, I don't know, 0.8 for the typical slope of the pool. Okay, with this, it's a very quick way to decide where to put for compute the tail index, and for each case, given a p-value, who lets to reject or not. And in the end, you can see with the packet the CV plot, who show with the behavior of data, and to reproduce the typical log-log representation, in this case for complementary complementary distribution function. And here you can see that the yellow is the fit, the model, with the data decided for the previous function. And the blue is the data. Okay, the second part, and the most important, because I am going to talk about the fit block of abbreviation. Okay, I am going to use the previous explanation for to let to explain how we are going to interview in this part. The first one is to review which is the meaning of field law of abbreviation, because more or less the most easy way to say is words that are frequent tends to be short. It's the most quick way to say it. Okay, from a mathematical point of view, in order to translate all the theory, all the approach, or the theoretical approach that you know, is you have two measures for a given time, for a given word. One of them is length and the other one is frequency. Then the sentence maybe attempt to characterize the relation, the independence or dependence between two measures, length and absolute frequency. I got the frequency. Consider L for length, F for absolutely frequency, and L for relative frequency. Okay, the intuition is so quick that, say, this sentence attempts to exist a relation between the random variables. Then we are talk about bivariate models, when you have two variables. When you have two variables, what you have to do?
I'm very sorry, I don't understand it. Length was what? Length of what? Length of the word?
Length of the word.
How many characters?
How many characters?
And then the second variable was the frequency of this word.
Yeah.
And you want to consider the connection. Okay. Sorry.
Yes, I know the expert can consider some other way to measure the length, in order that really the length attempts to characterize in some ways the effort of the human for reproduce some communication. But now is an example, and in the sense that I am going to remark that methodological approach from theoretical point of view in analyze this bivariate relation or no relation. Then, easy concept, everybody knows, which is the independence, because the first one is to consider if are independence, then the rule is true or not. Okay, the main idea is two events are independent when the probability of intersection is a product of probabilities. This is the main. And this one is going to reproduce that the density of the joint distribution is can be expressed, can be defined by the product of density, probability density functions. I remember that these are for absolutely continuous case. But then yes, it's maybe so easy for you. For a discrete case, the same. Probability is only translate directly that. Okay, this is the idea of independence. Then, when you are thinking in independence, the most easy is, this is a simulation, only simulation to that. When you are thinking in independence, you can imagine the normal distribution. This is the behavior of two random normal distribution independent. When you have two random, you have XP normal, in your mean, you have that they are independent. This is the behavior that I am going to see. This is a X, A, and here level set for the joint distribution. Okay? And the relation is something like this. Everybody know this idea where you can put here the regression lines. Okay, this idea of normal distribution is so dangerous because for normal distribution it's a good idea for to interpret the results, but not always the behavior of the relation is like that. The idea of transformation is okay, but the first one that you have to think is given two random variables, if are independent, it's like that. If are not independent, maybe it's like that. Maybe very strange, because the relation can be very, very complex, can be some mixture of distributions. But the most easy way to put dependence is to do that. The most easy way to put a dependence between two normal distributions is consider only one coefficient, you know, Pearson correlation, and to consider just that. Consider bivariate exponential. The picture is not too much, but I want to see which is the really, it's so easy from a theoretical point of view. In if I are exponential, are our independence, the level set is exactly that. But I want to, you can see when you have a simulation or when you have real data, that is not exactly that. Remember that the level sets are equidistant, because now the level sets are plot in log scale. Okay, when you consider exponential with exponential, it's recommended to consider a log scale for the level sets. And then you can see equidistance if you have in this situation. And if the exponential and exponential are related, but for instance this one, this is a very easy relation between two exponential distributions. But you can see that the only part you can understand is this one, in here, they are equidistant level sets. But the other one is so difficult to analyze. And in fact, when you have really exponential and exponential, you have several data who is going to obey here. If you are not going exactly to obtain that. This is a simulation. Remember that it is independent. It's important in your mind you have this in mind. Okay, the measures for relation for normal distribution, Pearson correlation characterized the most easy way to relate. There are several ones like Kendall's or Spearman correlation, but more general, you can consider a distance correlation. I am not going to explain that now, but if you don't know, if you don't meet distance correlation, I really recommend because it's a very good way to analyze the independence of the random variables. Finally, tail dependence coefficient is another coefficient or other way to analyze the dependence. Tail dependence corresponds or independent, let's say. The independence is clear. This one is an important reason. The tail independence is, you have to imagine. You can take this random variable and the other one, and again, could, and I'm going to consider the path that is in here. I am going to show only the distribution in this path. Maybe your distribution, like here, is not independent. But if you are going to good, in the end, more or less, you are going to obtain here something like that. You are going to obtain independence. Then you can, maybe your random variables are dependent, but are tail independent. Okay, this is a joint work with Victor Navas and Eduard Vives, and of course the colleagues in Barcelona. Is the idea of to consider a bivariate power law. If a power law was that exists a point where you see something like this, when you plot a log in log-log scale, the probability density function. The idea now is, okay, when I have a bivariate, X and E, and I'm going to consider when I put log here, and log in level sets, like in the previous example here. Then if in some place you are going to get something like this, you say that exists a point and a line who characterize a region with a bivariate power law. This will be the bivariate power law. A strictly definition is that exists an affine transformation for two lines where you can do that. Let me to show only so quick a picture. This is an example. Two random variables who has power law distribution in the tail, but something else. And you can see these lines decide where is the affine transformation, then translate the data, and in here, in the first quadrant, you get exactly the independence. The most important is one that you get when you do that, the expression of bivariate power law is that. It's not exactly that, it's that in a region. There exists a region where you can write the density function, the joint density function, like only a group. Okay. Yeah. Okay. When you have power law, when you have a power law, if X is power law, log X, and if E is power law, log E, are exponential and exponential. This is main point. Because I was showing example with exponential and exponential, bivariate exponential. The reason is because when you have two power laws, you can consider log-log scale and you can see the measure of two exponential random variables. Okay, this is the result from Larissa, from length between join with absolute frequency. In here, length is not log transformed. Why? Because length from, in here, the details, you can ask me one, but the random variable, the tail, is exponential. Okay? Then length, the tail is exponential. Then I don't need to log transform. But we analyze absolute frequency, that everybody knows, a pair zip log, and then the tail is power log. Then I need to transform in log scale. Then if I do in here log and here it's not necessary, in some way I have to obtain something like exponential with exponential. And then if you see that, you remember that was the behavior of independency, and you can see that, that really are independence maybe. This is the if length and absolute frequency, if they are independent, then the Zipf law of abbreviation don't hold? No. No, because when you have two exponential distributions independent, always you are going to see that the most frequency are short. Because the idea is if one of them take high values, the other one no. It's so difficult to understand that it's a behavior of two independent random variables. But if you want, I can give you some other examples more natural, but it's important to remark that this behavior is not necessary approach for to attempt to dependence. However, are independence? No. However, if I plot the level set, there are something like this. In here it's not very good, but the idea is in here there is something like that. You can see this part where I am going to show this affine transformation. Then in fact I see that in here, in this part, but I need to put like here and like here, I am going to obtain a part with a bigger yet power law. But not for all. And the most important, exists a relation. In here, the behavior is dependent. More beautiful picture is to represent the same that like before, but with colors. But this picture is interesting because I was using this kind of picture for to analyze if the shape of each language is in Biblia. I was analyzing the video in 1,400 languages, different languages. Always the behavior is that. Then using this kind of image, I was using some statistical techniques in data mining for to decide if it's the same shape, and always it's the same shape for all languages. You have this part and this other one.
So what
is the color? What is the color?
Yeah.
What does the color signify?
The red is like before. Mm-hmm. It's going to increase here. In fact, it's like a
frequency. Okay.
You here is no maybe with level
so
setting.
In the yellow part you have dependence, but in the red part you don't have dependence.
Sorry?
No, the yellow is high frequency, and the red is
just a density function.
The red? Because the colors is not good.
No, it's fine.
No, it's good.
I thought your point before was that only in a certain area you have dependence, and in the other areas you don't have dependence between length and frequency. Wasn't that your point?
Repeat.
I thought that in the plot that you showed before, you said there is an area where we have a length frequency dependence, but there are areas where we don't have a length frequency dependence, right?
Right.
And I thought that that's what you tried to show here with the colors as well.
Huh? Yes, it's the same, exactly. I tried to show with the colors the same behavior that before.
If they were independent, the colors would be totally different.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So the idea that you see, this one now is a good picture, but this one show no independence.
The independence would be, the yellow would be on the left, in the bottom. If they were independent, the yellow one would be at 0, 0.
For instance, if you, with this picture, moment, but if you put here, this was like in the text. This is only a bit, I think it's better than previous picture because this idea of pyramid of planes is more clear. This is this idea of bivariate power law. Okay, summary of the results, analyzing the visual and the Universal Declaration of Human Rights in order to have different languages and different length of text. And in the end, we can, independence is always rejected, are not dependence, always this behavior in the path, in the interior of the picture, and the tail independence is not rejected. There are several ways, now there are further research around to test tail independence, but now with the methods, the current methods, never even rejected that exists a tail independence. And I say that previous behavior with level set is invariant for all languages, for all size of the text. And then, which is a conclusion from statistical modeling, is a bivariate power law has to be considered in order to characterize the extremes of this behavior, this trivial distribution. But if you want to use more complex model, maybe you can consider some mixture of model, because one point that is not further explored, but let me to explain is this behavior is characterized for three parts. In fact, there are something like this. There are some strange parts. There are other with this kind of behavior. With this level set, and in here is empty. It's not too much bigger, but they are here. This one suggests that maybe there are a mixture. There may be a two class of types with two types of bivariate relation, and you observe the joint, the mixture of two models. This is only an idea in order to go more further research. Over bivariate power law. But no more statistical modeling. I return to the Zipf law of abbreviation for the finish. The Zipf law of abbreviation says words that are frequent strength to be short. In this sense, okay. We can analyze from a mathematical point of view. I only want to analyze this sentence. I can say, okay, I'm going to consider when I have two words with two lengths and two frequency, I'm going to analyze when, which is the probability of the length is increasing when the frequency is decreasing. Or then if L and F was independent, this is actually 0.5. But you can see this is a result with the visual data of this probability. Always, you can see, because this is very small, in here is 0.5, then there are two languages who are not going to with, this rule is not held. For the other ones, from a statistical approximation, it's true, and there are limit cases for some languages. Remark that it's a variation of Kendall correlation. It's a bit correction of Kendall correlation in order that your variables are positive. But we can think it's only one idea. Other idea for analyze the property. I can think, okay, then the mean of the length is decreasing if the frequency is increasing. I am going to attend to the mean. This is the idea. Then formally it's going to analyze the expectation of that. And this is the relation that you described, the Pearson correlation. But for to finish, maybe a way can be going to do that, changing the mean for the maximum, like in Isabel theory. Then analyze the maximum of L when the frequency is fixed. Then this idea that this has to be going to decrease when F is going to increase. And the results of this analysis, only from
no inference result, only was analyzing the different languages, you can see, remark, that now F is going, in this picture, F, the frequency is analyzing with relative frequency. The A is negative in log scale, because it's between 0 and 1, and our previous talk say, the maximum possibility is 0. And like before, the frequency has to take globally, but length is not necessary. Then the relation have to be described, that relation between log and log of frequency and length. You can see this one is the previous picture for different kind of languages. And in general, you have that. This is the scatter plot and the bigger points and just the maximum for each one. For each length, you pay the maximum. And for these ones, you pay this overall relation in order to know which is the slope of that. But, well, when you do that, you get a slope that if you are going to translate to zero, in order that the limit case for a very large test have to be involved, all data, you have this situation. This is the relation, and blue is translated to zero. I'm contain all the data. But, I mean, this is the typical situation in all languages, like 1,300 languages, or 1,000 for more or less. Then maybe all languages can be described in this way. So there are some ones, like 70, with this behavior, that when you put this line, blue, in zero, there are a point outside. But these languages attempt to that there are a word in a Bible that is not very good codificated. But only one. And this has to be an outlier, because with this model, this one has to be for a fixed length, this one is exponential distribution. And for instance, in this case, this one is exponential distribution, and you can check that this one is really outlier. Okay? And other situation, but only for like 20 languages, is this one. When you do that, there are several points for set. Then you really want to put all of them, it's so close, so late that your results with this method. In each case, the idea is that maybe in here, the region for Abbreviation, maybe something like this, or something like this. In the typical case, the region was something like this. Okay, then analyzing the parameter C for this tensor relation, the slope. I don't show any other picture, but the result was that this value of C is always around 0.2, 0.3, 0.5, 0.6, and from theoretical point of view, this value is going to show which is the relation between the tail index here and the tail index here. But the tail index is a heavy case. Then the length has to be considered an exponential of the length for to detect this tail index. Okay. I finish.
Thanks for the presentation. Can you go back to one of the slides? Just a quick one. So I lost a bit the final limitation.
You can see.
Yeah. Can you go back to slide?
No.
The next one. Two slides before the end.
What?
Una más.
La antepenúltima.
La antepenúltima. La antepenúltima.
Did I get you right that you were proposing different criteria to look at the data and determine whether it was a dependence out there in the data, right? Was that what you were doing here? Just have a number of ways of looking at the data to see whether there is an actual dependency, right? Is that true?
Yeah, it's true. This one and the other one are ways that you can attempt to describe a relation mm-hmm. between two random variables. And
right.
in order to show yeah. something like a field law of abbreviation.
Right. So I got it right. What I missed is what was the. So you have all of these different ways of describing the or analyzing this dependency, but what is the purpose of looking at all of them? Or what are you learning by looking at statistics through all of these tests? Like in statistics, what you would do is find the test that yields the best power, for instance, and just stick with that, because the other things are irrelevant. For instance, I'm not surprised that looking at the maximum yields, in general, worse statistical properties than looking at the mean value, just because of the variance of the estimator is going to be much better for the mean than for the maximum. So I'm sure I might have missed something, but I want to understand better what do you gain by looking at all of these different tests, whether what you want for point of view statistics is to go to the best one and just stick with that.
Yeah, I can say something about it as somebody who pushed Karen to investigate this kind of relation. So if you look at the relationship between frequency and length, you see a cloud of points. Okay?
Yeah.
But people in modern linguistics have been proposing functional dependencies. Okay? How can you seriously propose a functional dependency in such a cloud of points? Okay? Is it really? I mean, the standard approach is I want to understand the behavior of the expectation of length given frequency. Okay? But with such a dispersion, does it make sense? One of the aims was, could we, forget about the functional dependency for a moment and try to say something about the variation in the cloud of points. Mm-hmm. So the last study was aimed at that. So we may not easily understand. Maybe it's impossible, to claim that there is a functional dependency valid for all points. Okay, but let us see if we can still try to understand how this variation is constrained. That was one of the goals. And surprisingly, she finds through this simple transformation, she finds a sort of triangle where you can put many languages in.
I think it's
linked to the evolutionary pressures that are behind the. This cloud of points. There's a very important phenomenon that she reported that I think it's becoming more and more important over time, which is the fact that when you look at different regions, she said there isn't, you have this kind of linear bar here, we have some variation below, and then you have an empty area. The empty area is a place where you have words that have, that corresponds to words that have low frequency and such. And a length.
No words with.
Such a large variation. Well, the potential for a lot of very large length, but this is practically empty unless you get to the bar. Is it something related to the to pressures? Ultimate pressure is something just an accident, the real accident of this divided distribution, something like that. I'm speaking too much.
Okay, it's for me.
Well, I think I'm going to put on the linguistics hat now. And there is, one has to be careful with, I'm not going to go so much into the statistics of what you've been doing, but into the measures that you've been using. So you've been taking a measure of frequency and a measure of length. And as Professor Kamalashi was pointing out, what do you mean by length? And you were saying, well, that's the number of characters in the world. But of course, you're going to get a hugely different things depending on which language you're looking at. So in some orthographic systems, those letters correspond more or less to sounds. In some others, they might correspond to syllables. In some others, they might correspond to the consonants in the word. Think of, for instance, Arabic or Hebrew. So here you're measuring very different things. If you add to this that the definition of what is a word is actually not so clear from a linguistic point of view. So if you take, for instance, polysyntactic languages, like many of the languages spoken in North America, you find that a word is basically a whole sentence, and it's very difficult to find what is the limit of a word or another. So at the end, what you have is, for instance, if you take the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, you have a huge sample of languages there in which the lengths that you're measuring in each language, which I suppose you took just the spaces, the space between spaces, for those languages that have spaces, because many orthographic systems do not have any spaces, mean absolutely different things. So it's no surprise that you're very likely to find very different regimes for different languages. So maybe those three regimes you're finding actually have an explanation that's actually typological, either related to the nature of the language or to the nature of the orthographic system that that language is using. The solution, the only possible solution that could get to this would be actually measuring the length in milliseconds of those words when they're uttered, or something like that.
But then, you still don't get around the
issue. Give me a ground, give me a ground.
No, actually, maybe I can comment on this. So yeah, I think you're absolutely right. We should look at it typologically by, say, language families and then also by writing systems and so on. That's absolutely right. Although, you know, the issue of what is a word and the issue of what is a character and what's the difference between a spoken word and a written word, these are kind of issues which you always run into. And even for polysynthetic languages, typologists would agree that, you know, we can have white spaces in between words, right?
Oh, well, I happen to work in a department that's specialized in polysynthetic languages. And I can tell you that they object strongly whenever you talk about words.
Well, I mean, if we cannot agree on what a word is, then we cannot do linguistics. If we cannot agree on what the basic...
A lot of linguists would disagree with that.
Yeah, but I mean, you have to agree on some basic unit that you're looking at.
That's why people tend to focus on units of sound and some of the descriptions of full atoms.
I mean, I think it's interesting, but just trying to go back to the interesting talk as well. So, just to see if I understand, you are saying that the Zipf abbreviation is valid on the average, but not on the tail. Is this?
No.
No.
No. The Zipf abbreviation holds always. In fact, you can if you suppose are independent, holds. If you suppose that the relation is exactly given by something like that, hold, because it's over zero bonfire. If you consider it is something like this one, you do this with this methodology, you see hold.
But what is
it? Because the big law with this approach attends to the points have to be that have to exist this line. Divide, no points, all points.
But what was the tail independence result you said?
The tail independence?
How is
the tail related? Independence is important in order to join the solution, to join model. The tail independence is always in all languages is present in the sense that for a very, very large length, or very, very large frequency, The relation don't exist, but if don't exist relation are independent, and the law of a relation hope for independent relations. Then really the series of variation always is going to hold, or not, for every interpretation here. And the tail independence is only the way to understand the more clear way when hold is law.
Maybe we should
hope
for the question and start.
Well, I just wanted to say, looking at this plot, so let's see if I'm not missing. If I look at words longer than 10 or so, it looks like they're independent, right? I get the triangle and so on. So to me, it looks like very long words. So is that what you're saying? So for very long words, there's independence.
Very long, yes, you can imagine that.
Right, yeah, you cut
the
Yes, sure.
Like the picture suggests. Really, the picture suggests something like this part, maybe other part, and this part. You can see in this part, it's a direct relation. It's no, the thick globe is not going to hold here. For a small frequency and a small length, the relation is.
I get that. So there's abbreviation for short and medium words, if you want. So for very long words, there's no need to economize anything. It doesn't really matter. They are independent. That makes sense. I don't know.
Most two-dimensional distributions are tail independent. Tail independence is.
Tail independence is
very difficult.
No wonder that the gods.
Okay, let's conclude this session and let's go for lunch.